All right, so happy return to the videos. Okay, so naming numbers. So I will go into kind of naming decimals. It's interesting when students are given numbers, actually not even students, I mean pretty much anybody. It's rare that we fill out checks nowadays, but you know, we used to, and it's still pretty useful to know how to name numbers. So if you want to be able to name a number, it kind of comes naturally to us, although we sometimes botch the process. But I'll give you a few steps and then I'll give you a ton of examples so that you can hopefully understand how to properly name numbers. Well, when you begin naming, the first thing that you should know is how to name a triad, which is basically a grouping of three numbers. And that becomes important because in numbers, we kind of separate them into these triads, into groupings of threes, and then we give each triad a name. Now, you know, if you know place values for decimal numbers, I guess I'll put up a link if you've forgotten them, then it makes naming a lot easier. So what are these triads and in terms of examples? Well, if I gave you something like this, you know, you should be able to name this. So this is a grouping of three, and this would have been simply 209. Now, avoid the word end, because the word end actually stands for decimal when you're properly naming numbers. So try not to say 209, we just say 209. So we can keep going here, and I wanna just highlight a few things that will come out at us. This grouping of three, so it's a different grouping, so it's 138. Notice I didn't say end. What I am going to highlight here, unlike the previous example, is that when you're naming these, it's fine when you say 138, but when you have to write it out, you're going to actually hyphenate the pairings of twos that happen in each triad. So here's a pairing. Now, we didn't have a pairing here because we only had a nine, so it wasn't any pairings. What I mean by a pairing is, for example, if you get into the 20s, so 20s or 30s or 40s, 50s, so on, up to into the 90s, then you have a pairing. So this would have been written, this word, so 138, which most people would write, but we actually hyphenate right there. So don't forget to hyphenate your pairings. And I'll give you another example in terms of a grouping of three, let's say 967. So here we have to hyphenate these 67. So this would have been 967. So notice I hyphenate the 67 right there. That's what I mean. So you'll see this pattern happening. Now, the other concept is when numbers are negative, we actually state negative. So don't say, you know, minus, for instance, if we had something like this, we would say negative 209. We wouldn't say minus 209. So the negative is actually stated as a negative. So the second one right here, I would have said negative 138. And then if I made this negative, this would have been negative 967. So those are triads, and those are simpler to group. And I believe that, you know, as you kind of are carrying on through your education, you're going to come up with these. But they do get harder because now what happens if we start making them bigger and bigger? So here are some examples that I'll give you. Okay, so right here, and this gets a little hairy, especially at the one at the bottom. So here's some examples. So how would we group these? So as I said, we should group them into triads, so groupings of three. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that every triad is going to have three numbers in them. For instance, this example right here, so how would we state this? So it is positive. So what I would say is, so I do have a grouping of three, and I'm starting from the back. So here's a grouping of three right there. And then my second grouping of three starts right here, although I don't have three numbers there. I only have one number, and that number is just three. But I'll point out something interesting. Well, this is in a separate grouping and it's in a different triad. That second triad, if you remember from place values, is basically the thousands triad. So right here, what I would state, if I wanted to say this properly, this would have been three, because that's I only have a three in this triad, 3,000. Now notice that I actually add the triad name into it. So this is the thousand triad. So it's 3,000. I don't say any ends because I don't have any decimals. And then I just proceed and I continue on and I will say 200. Notice there is no hyphenation with the 200, but there will be hyphenation now with the 86. So that is because I have a grouping of, or a pairing of two right there. So that's how I would actually properly state this. So this would have been 3,286. That's that particular example. Let's move over to the next one, which goes a little bit harder. So for this one, how would I name that? Well, so what I have is, I have basically three triads here. So the triads, so here's a grouping of three, that's that. Here's a grouping of three, this is the thousands. And then I actually go into the million triad right here, but I only have a one in there. All right, so how I would name it is in the following way, and you can write it down. So it would have been 1,000,000, that's the one. Then I would have said 406. So every triad we just say normally, so it's 406. But now we have to end it with the triad name. So it's 406,000. And then the last triad is 270. That's how I would actually state it. So let me write it. I'll fast forward the writing for you so it speeds it up. And there you have it. So it's 1,406,270. So it's basically, I mean, if I had it all in a line, it would just follow one after the other. There are no hyphenations here at all. The 70 at the end, okay, it's on its own. So if it was 71, then I would hyphenate it. Or if it was 72 or 73, I would hyphenate that. Now, the key thing is that I kind of group it all into kind of these triads, into groupings of three, and then I go ahead and start naming. So here is the next one that I have for you. Now, this one is negative. So I would say negative 37,000, because that's the triad. And then I would continue and I would say 429. Now, I would have to hyphenate two things. I would have to hyphenate the 37 and then put 1,000 after it. And then I would have to hyphenate the 29. So I'm going to write this out as well for you in fast forward fashion. All right, and I'm back. So we have negative 37,429, and notice the 37 was hyphenated and the 29. So you hyphenate in every single triad. Now, just a note, okay, so as you were watching, so maybe you noticed, forgot to put the 1,000 here in the previous example. So maybe you caught that, great. And then here's the last one, and notice in all of these examples so far, I haven't really talked about decimal naming. These are just regular integer numbers. So this one is really hectic, but what we have is the following. Okay, so I have negative. Now notice how many, you know, groupings or triads I have in this number right here. So I have negative 29. Now this is actually billion. So I have negative 29 billion, 499 million, 7,482. That's a lot, okay, to say. So again, it's negative 29,499,007,482. Most people, when they read this, because there's so many, they definitely will probably stick an end somewhere. But the formal way of saying it, you can't use an end unless there's a decimal. Which brings us to the next set of examples, which are decimals. So here we have these. Now, it turns out that when you're working with decimals, you should probably separate it into two separate things, which is going to make your life a lot easier. It's kind of naming twice. And the only thing you do is you have to understand that a decimal, we say the word end. And then for decimal numbers, when we complete, we have to end with the place value. So I'm going to show you that through these examples. For instance, what I like to do is when I work with decimals, I separate them into two separate things. I kind of tell myself, All right, so what would I do if I didn't have a decimal and I just had an integer, right? So in this case, it's just 18. Well, that's not very difficult. So I would name that and I would say, okay, so this is 18. Whenever we see a decimal like this, we say the word end. So the person who is listening, or maybe if it was reading out, that end represents the decimal. And then we have to actually state what's after the decimal. Now, what is after the decimal here? Well, after the decimal, I only have 42. So this would have been 42. And notice I hyphenate. Now you might say, okay, this is pretty much it. So it's separated into three things. What's before the decimal, we say and for the decimal, and then we just simply state the number which is after the decimal. In this case, it's 42. But because it's after the decimal, we have to end it with the place value of that last digit. And this is why you have to know those place values. You can go back to that link if you forgot it. So what's the place value of that second digit? Well, that place value is the hundredths. So we would say 42 hundredths. And this is an S because it's plural. So that's how we would actually state this decimal. The one just below it, okay, so within here, so what we would have is we would divide it out. So again, I would divide it into three components. This, the decimal itself, and then what happens after the decimal, right there. So if I take just the first portion, which is this one, all I would say, I mean, it's a positive number, so I would say 306. Then I use the word end to represent the decimal, and then I represent what's after the decimal. Well, after the decimal, I only have an 8. And it's interesting, because the way that I would write it is in the following way. So I would have 306. Then I say the word end to represent the decimal. And then I continue, and then I just say 8, because that's all I have after the decimal. But I have to end it with the place value of that 8. And that is, so it's tens, hundredths, and then thousandths. So 8 thousandths. So don't forget to put that in, 8 thousandths. Now, because it is plural, so 8 is more than 1, we say thousandths. If it was, for example, 001 after the decimal, we'd just say 1,000th, right? We wouldn't say the S, so just be careful. So if there's more than 1, you always add an S there. All right, so how would the other ones look like? So now I'm not going to necessarily write them down, but I will state them. So the one just below it, which is this one right here, I would say, so again, I start right here. This is negative 2, and now I say this, 329. So you would hyphenate the 29, so 329. And then I have to end it with the place value of that. Well, what's the place value? This is tens, hundredths, thousandths, ten thousandths. So it's ten thousandths. So in total, the entire decimal number would have been stated negative 2 and 329 ten thousandths. That's how we would state that. Now, how about this one, which is just below it? Here, so again, so I say what's before the decimal, which is 112. And now this is tricky. Don't think that this is just a 3. We do actually state the entire thing. So our number is this number. So this would have been 3,000, right? So it's not 3, it's not 112 and 3. It is 112 and 3,000, because we are actually having all of these decimal digits there. And then the last one, again, is 10,000. So this one is interesting. It's 112 and 3,000, 10,000ths. That's quite a mouthful to say, all right? And if anybody is watching, maybe write it down, okay, in the comments. Let's see if you can get it. And just as a challenge for you. You know, you can, how would you say this if it didn't have the actual zeros behind? So that's a question for you, and you can put in the comments and I'll try to answer if you got it right or not. And then here's the last one, because it seems very simple, but what happens when you don't have a number in front, or the number in front of the decimal is zero? So do we say, for instance here, negative 0 and 15 hundredths? No, you don't typically say that. I mean, you can, but you would typically, if there's a zero in front, you don't really say it. So you would just say negative and then whatever is after the decimal. So you would say negative 15, and this would have been hundredths. That's all that you would have to say here. So this would have been just negative 15 hundredths. That's all. So you don't have to say the negative 0 and 15 hundredths. That's what you would have had. And here's a great challenge. I would ask you to, you know, write it in the comments. And let's see if someone can write it. This is going to take you a bit of time. But let's try to knock this off as our last kind of challenge. So how would I say this?